It seems like they have a very warm prelude to President Moon Jae-in's chance to step up to the podium. So before we go straight to the highlights, the highlight of the day, the special event in Berlin, we turn to our special guest in the studio today. We have Professor Hwang Jong-uk from Hanguk University of Foreign Studies in the studio with us. Professor, thank you so much for making time for us at such a short notice.
Thank you for having me.
Well, this event, a prelude to the G20 summit, I guess in some sense it is something that's bigger to South Korea and the South Korean leader than the G20 event itself.
That's right. I mean, this is the first time that the world leaders get to see President Moon in person. And the fact that they've all been briefed about the candlelight rallies and the impeachment and all the very drastic changes the Korean political scene has gone through, I think this is the real chance for President Moon to make his mark.
Do you feel that all the drama surrounding the prelude to the president's opportunity to earn the public's trust and support to be the president that the public want, do you think this adds possibly to the president's favorability in terms of the positive, the public light from the world's eyes?
For sure. I think, you know, everybody has heard about President Moon's, you know, previous career as a human rights lawyer. That's sort of the first few words that comes out in describing him. But nobody really knows his chops as, you know, diplomat, as a statesman, especially with the North Korean threat looming at large. So I think, you know, showing a very, you know, firm and a very flexible stance, I think will go a long way in boosting his standing.
Right, and this will be a great opportunity for President Moon and South Korea to let the world know where we are. We're not just a country that's on the receiving end of the tip of the missiles from North Korea. And I understand that President Moon made some minor adjustments to his speech after the summits with Angela Merkel, the German Chancellor, and President Xi Jinping of China. What kind of minor clicks do you think President Moon may have made? Wait, we are hearing that President Moon Jae-in is about to take center stage right now. There he is, stepping up to the podium. This is also the stage where former President Kim Dae-jung was there.
예, 감사합니다.
Thank you very much.
존경하는 독일 국민 여러분.
Honorable German citizens.
고국에 계신 국민 여러분.
My fellow Korean citizens at home.
하울젠 괴로부 재단
Director Hausen of the Korber Foundation.
전 동독 총리님을 비롯한
Former East Germany Prime Minister Modrow and distinguished guests.
먼저 냉전과 분단을 넘어
First of all,
통일을 이루고
You have realized unification going beyond Cold War and division. And with this, you are at the forefront of European integration and world peace. I pay tribute to Germany and its citizens. And I would like to thank the German government and Korber Foundation for providing me today's opportunity. Moreover, I send my warm condolences to late Prime Minister Helmut Kohl, his families, and the citizens of Germany. Even during the difficult times of the Cold War, he has led the unification of Germany and unification of integration of Europe through active diplomacy, and Republic of Korea will always remember these achievements. Ladies and gentlemen, here in Berlin, 17 years ago, Korea's President Kim Dae-jung has delivered the Berlin Declaration, which has provided the framework for inter-Korean talks and cooperation. Here, the Alte Stadthaus is a historic site where negotiations for German Unification Treaty were carried out. Today, I would like to deliver Republic of Korea's new government's plan for peace on the Korean Peninsula here at a very significant location. Ladies and gentlemen, the experience of German unification gives us a lesson as the world's only divided country. Along with the hopes for unification, it's presenting us with directions to go forward. This, above all, is the importance of the process towards unification. Germany's unification has led us to acknowledge the importance of the process of cooperation and peace based on mutual respect. You, through these processes, were able to decide your unification based on accumulated trust. The citizens of East and West Germany carried out exchanges and cooperation in diverse areas, and the two governments have compensated these systematically. Non-political people-to-people exchanges have broke the political ideologies and opened the hearts of the citizens. The East policy also continued for two decades. Constant policies were possible despite the change in the regime due to the citizen support and cooperation from the international society. While peaceful order was being established in Europe, Germany witnessed the possibility of its own unification. Walking with the international society and at times persuading the international society, it secured a stable security and was guaranteed of its support for the relationship between the two Germanies. Prime Minister Willy Brandt, first step towards German unification was completed by Prime Minister Kohl, who is from a different political party. I also believe that we need trans-political cooperation for peace and mutual prosperity on the Korean Peninsula. Ladies and gentlemen, for our own citizens who wish to see peace and unification on the Korean Peninsula, Berlin is always remembered along with Berlin Declaration of President Kim Dae-jung. His Berlin Declaration led to the first inter-Korean talks summit in 2000, and the two Koreas led a big transformation towards a road for cooperation and reconciliation, putting behind the six decades of confrontation and tensions after the division and the war. This was later followed by President Nomuyon, who, along with the second inter-Korean summit in 2007, set a new milestone for development of inter-Korean relations and peace. Presidents Kim and Noh have carried out international cooperation to establish peace on the Korean Peninsula. And during these days, the six-party talks adopted September 19 declaration and February 13 agreement that contain the principles and direction for resolving the North Korea's nuclear issue. There were also progress made in relationship between North Korea and the U.S. and Japan. I would also like to embark on a courageous journey of establishing peaceful structure on the Korean Peninsula through a more active role of the Republic of Korea. The greatest challenge the Korean Peninsula faces now is the North nuclear issue. It's continuing its nuclear and missile provocations and is threatening peace on the Korean Peninsula. The missile provocations just 2 days ago is very disappointing and is truly a wrong decision. It's not only a clear violation of the UN Security Council resolution, but a denial of the international society's repeated warnings. Above all, for our government, who has laid out the road for dialogue through the Seoul Washington summit, this is ever more regretful. The North's decision is reckless. It has brought the international society's punishment upon itself. If North Korea ceases provocations and shows its intentions towards denuclearization, it can get help and support from the international society, and it's testing our government's such intentions. I hope North Korea will not cross an unreturnable bridge. It needs to abandon its nuclear and missile development and seek ways to cooperate with the rest of the world. Complete, verifiable, and irreversible denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula is a unified request from the international society and an absolute condition for peace on the Korean Peninsula. Such strong determination is the only way to secure North Korea's security. So now, I believe it is the last opportunity for North Korea to make a right choice and is the most fitting time. At a time when military tensions are reaching its limits, the need for talks is most desperate than ever before. It's also important that the basic conditions have been laid out to begin peace process on the Korean Peninsula. The Republic of Korea and U.S. recently have agreed that sanctions is a diplomatic means and that we would like to denuclearize the peninsula in a peaceful manner. We also declared that we do not have hostile policies against the North. We confirmed that the international society can provide a brighter future according to the decisions made by the North. In order to overcome the crisis on the Korean Peninsula, the two countries also share the view that two Koreas must improve relations. President Trump has supported our leading role. I also share thoughts, the same thoughts with President Xi Jinping. Now we are only left with North Korea's decision. Resuming to the table for talks, moving away from the opportunity of hardly earned talks, all lie in the hands of North Korea. However, if the North does not halt its nuclear provocation, we have no other choice but choose stronger sanctions and pressure. Then we cannot guarantee peace on the Korean Peninsula and North Korea's security. I hope the strong will of our government and the international society towards peaceful peninsula is delivered to the North and is accepted as a crucial and urgent sign. Ladies and gentlemen, now I would like to introduce you the policy directions of our government to end the Cold War structure on the peninsula and to move towards long-lasting peace. Firstly, what we pursue is peace only. A peaceful peninsula is one with no threats from nuclear and war. It is one where two Koreas recognize, respect each other and live well together. We already know the way to peaceful peninsula. It's returning back to June 15th Joint Declaration and October 4th Normalization Declaration. With the two declarations, the two Koreas have made clear that our people are the main subject of inter-Korean issues. We have promised close cooperation, from economic cooperation to other social cooperation. We promise to go towards common prosperity. Based on mutual trust, we have made such agreement, and its spirits are still valid and very desperate as well. South and North Koreas must go back to the spirit where the two tried to realize a peaceful Korean peninsula. I would like to make it clear today, we do not want a collapse of North Korea. We will not seek unification through absorption of any kind. We will not seek artificial unification. Unification is a process of mutual existence and recovering the community of the people. Unification, when peace is settled, will naturally come based on inter-Korean talks. The only thing I myself and the government aim to realize is peace only. Second, we will seek denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula that guarantees North Korea's security. Last April, talks of a possible war swept across the Korean Peninsula and the world. Military tensions surrounding the peninsula is escalating. We must urgently alleviate these tensions on the peninsula. We must restore trust between the two Koreas. And to this end, we must seek exchanges and talks. North Korea must now halt its nuclear provocations. We must establish a military management system to prevent collision. A more fundamental solution is needed to this problem. The issue is getting more complex and difficult. We need a phased and comprehensive approach. Our government, along with the international society, will seek a complete abandon of nuclear of North Korea and alleviate any concerns in the North and improve North relations with U.S. and Japan. And we would like to solve this comprehensively. However, two hands must meet in order to clap. North Korea must completely stop its nuclear provocations and must come to bilateral and multilateral talks for denuclearization. Thirdly, we will seek a long-lasting peace structure. Since 1953, the Korean Peninsula for the past six decades is at a state of war. Such uncertainty cannot establish a stable peace. Whenever regimes change, the agreements between the two Koreas are shaking as well. We must have systemized peace, and we must have a legalization process for the agreement of the two Koreas. These spirits must be succeeded even there is a change in the regime, and they are the basic assets of the Korean Peninsula. In order to establish long-lasting peace on the Korean Peninsula, concerned parties must join in to establish a peace agreement on the Korean Peninsula. We need a very comprehensive approach towards a complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. Fourth, we will make a new economic map on the Korean Peninsula. The economic cooperation where two Koreas prosper is a very important foundation for peace on the Korean Peninsula. I have visions for a new economic map for the Korean Peninsula. When situations are better on the Korean Peninsula, I will draw out the new economic map. I will connect the two countries through an economic belt and establish an economic community where the two Koreas prosper. The railroads connecting the two Koreas will be reconnected, connecting Busan and Mokpo. The railroad will cross towards Pyongyang and Beijing and to Russia and Europe. And we will also make other cooperations possible. The two Koreas will prosper mutually. The two Koreas must realize the declaration, the October 4th declaration, and then we will see a new model of co-prosperity and a peaceful economy. Fifth, non-political exchanges will be carried out constantly aside from political and military conditions. Such exchanges between the two Koreas is a process to heal the pain of the two Koreas and to make peace from inside. In the two Koreas, there are many families who are divided due to war and division. And not being able to heal their wounds for over six decades is a very pitiful situation. And there are about 60,000 survivals who have requested to meet their families in the other Korea, and their average age is 81. We must help them to meet their families. This is a very urgent humanitarian issue. We also must avoid the two citizens to be damaged through division. When there is flood in North Korea, the damage comes directly to the citizens of North Korea. And there are no boundaries when it comes to natural disasters like wildfires. We must seek mutual means to address these problems. And we have promised to alleviate tensions and people-to-people exchanges is a very important and crucial energy to solve the inter-Korean relations. I will support wide range of people-to-people exchanges and support region-to-region exchanges. The universal human rights shall be respected on the Korean Peninsula as well. We need to raise our voices along with the international society to address the human rights issues of the North Korean citizens. Moreover, I will provide humanitarian cooperation which are practical for the citizens of North Korea. Ladies and gentlemen, I myself and our government will establish firm directions for our policies and are ready to realize these policies. We will hold hands together and walk towards a peace on the Korean Peninsula. We will suggest North Korea to begin with easier issues. First is solving the most urgent issue of humanitarian issue. Today marks the 10th anniversary of the October 4th Declaration, and October 4th also marks a very important national holiday for our citizens. So the two Koreas have agreed that we will have more meetings of the separated families in the declaration. And if we hold this event on the very special day, it will be a beginning, a very meaningful beginning indeed, to respect each other. If North Korea agrees to go a step further, I propose to visit the graves at this event. During the vision, the two Germanies have sent messages and hold telephone talks, and there is no reason that Korea cannot do this. If North Korea cannot make this happen urgently, we will open and allow North Korean citizens to come to their hometowns here in the South and to visit the graves of their families. Second is making a peace Olympic, is making Pyeongchang Olympics a peace Olympics by encouraging North Korea to join. In February of 2018, we will hold the Winter Olympics in Pyeongchang, which is only 100 kilometers from the division. And in 2020, the Olympics will be held in Tokyo. And 2 years later, it will be held in Beijing. And our government will like to celebrate these events along with North Korea. Sports has the power to connect the hearts of the people. The two Koreas and the world athletes will compete, sweating with each other. When they hug each other, the world will see peace through the Olympics. World leaders will send applause, and they will be able to expect a new beginning on the Korean Peninsula. As the IOC has promised to help North Korea to participate in the upcoming Pyeongchang Winter Olympics, I hope North Korea can participate. Third is halting the hostilities on the division line. Even at this hour, we are still beginning a soundless war. And the military tensions is not changing. Such military collision escalates tensions and dangers and is a big threat for the citizens of the two Koreas. July 27th marks the 64th anniversary of the truce treaty on the Korean Peninsula, and we must celebrate this occasion by halting all forms of hostilities against each other, and it will be a very significant opportunity. Fourth is resuming contact and talks between the two Koreas. Alleviating tensions on the peninsula is the most urgent issue. No high official contact is very dangerous. We need to engage in contact and make meaningful talks possible. Furthermore, when conditions are made and when there is an opportunity to overcome such confrontation on the Korean Peninsula, I am ready to meet with the leader of North Korea, Kim Jong-un. Including the nuclear talks and peaceful talks, I will put all of our common interest on the table and discuss cooperation on the Korean Peninsula. Beginning is important. We must stand up to take a step forward. I hope to see the determination of North Korea. Ladies and gentlemen, Germany has overcome the Cold War and established unification even before the Republic of Korea, but is now facing new challenges, including regionalism, terrorism, and refugees. Now, I hope that Germany overcomes such challenges and finishes the integration of the Europe and the, its own society. Republic of Korea as well will establish a peaceful Korean Peninsula. Starting from Berlin, the collapse of Cold War will be completed in Seoul and Pyongyang, and we will deliver to the world and the Northeast Asia new visions for peace. Germany and Korea will continuously walk towards peace. We will always stand together supporting each other. We will walk towards a better life for the future, a better future for the world, and let's go together. Thank you very much.
There you go. It ends with a very catchy South Korea-U.S. alliance phrase, 같이 갑시다, or let's go together. That was a very, very impressive speech. It didn't feel long at all, although it did take up a substantial amount of time. Professor, I think this is just as much as it is to the world. It seems like a message directed at North Korea. How do you think North Korea is responding? I'm sure they are watching this as we speak.
Right. I mean, it's in Berlin, and North Korea actually has embassy in Berlin. I'm sure they've been paying us close attention. I mean, you said it was a message towards North Korea. I'll actually be more specific. It felt like a personal letter to Kim Jong-un himself, basically. Basically, the end of the day, President Moon just say, hey, let's meet together and sit down and talk about everything.
Sit down and talk.
Exactly.
Of course, this is a different kind of let's sit down and talk instead of the more braggadocious tone that President Trump usually has when it comes to I'm ready to talk to Kim. Do you think they might, how do you think they might have responded to President Moon's emphasis on a slower procedure? Let's take it slow. Let's take baby steps, but definitely let's sit down and talk. We're open to dialogue. It seems like he could not emphasize that enough. How is North Korea responding to this? They are in some ways like a wounded animal. They feel threatened because of the 4 years of aggressive approach from the previous administration. How do you think this would change their approach towards dealing with South Korea?
So, I mean, basically that comes down to has President Moon's speech just now, as well as additional messages I'm sure that will flow from South Korea to North Korea, convince Kim Jong-un's personal mind, and I think that's a big if, because ever since President Moon has come into the office since, you know, May 10th, North Korea has basically rebuffed any kind of message, you know, reconciliatory messages that South Korea has sent, especially, you know, if you remember in Muju, in the Taekwondo event, the North Korean representative IOC Chang Woong basically said, well, sports diplomacy, that's you know, that really cannot happen until political issues are resolved.
They're still very uncertain about whether they want to take the first step, and that's a doozy for North Korea at this point. Well, we are offering them something that North Korea sorely needs, which is money, chance to make more money. Economic cooperation is what President Moon Jae-in emphasized on this time, and it seems like he has the right idea about how to get things done, because it almost sounded like he was taking a jab at the previous administration's rush to get THAAD deployed in South Korea. He's saying, we are going to take this slowly after thorough discussions from a more cultural level. Like you say, the sports exchanges might be a good way to break the ice.
Yeah, and one thing to note is that he kept on mentioning the two declarations from June 15th and October 7th, October 4th, I'm sorry. Those were the key two declarations that were made jointly between South and North Korea under Presidents Kim Dae-jung and Noh Moo-hyun, which actually North Korea were very upset that those declarations were basically ignored under Lee Myung-bak and Park Geun-hye administrations. I mean, just now, if you heard President Moon's speech closely, you know, he said as if the past two administrations didn't really exist. And he basically saying, I'm just willing to carry
clean
on.
Clean slate.
Exactly. I'm just going to pick up where Kim Dae-jung and Noh Moo-hyun, those two presidents left off. I'm just going to pick up where they left off and sort of fail to mention anything that previous two presidents have done. And that's a clear message to North Korea saying that, hey, you know, let's just pretend the past 9 years didn't happen. Whether Kim Jong-un will actually take a liking to that, I don't know. I mean, the condition that President Moon has set down, which is, you know, just one, but big one, is that you need to freeze all your nuclear tests and missile tests. And I think that's going to be a big pill for North Korea to swallow.
Right. And you mentioned that he wants to remind North Korea of the good times, the more promising era. It certainly seems like a good reminder to North Korea, especially what with the predecessor of the current leader, Kim Jong-un's father, not being around anymore. So this would be a good reminder for perhaps Kim Jong-un and his leadership class to perhaps look back at what happened back then, and maybe they can feel they can trust South Korea again. But at the same time, from other world leaders' point of view, would they see this as too much of trying to ride on the coattails of the former liberal leaders on the part
perhaps
of Moon Jae-in?
I mean, you know, especially from the hardliners from, you know, various Western governments, they might actually look at South Korea and say, hey, are you appeasing North Korea? I mean, there's certainly that danger. But I think the speech is not really, the way he phrased it, it wasn't really addressed to the Western leaders, but actually it very much felt like a personal letter to Kim Jong-un himself.
Right. Do you think perhaps because of the sudden, it can send a bit of a mixed signal, because
sure,
he did conduct some military drills to send a stern message to North Korea, and that was a welcome move by President Donald Trump. And when you get positive response from the former reality show star, it might not be a very good grade in terms of the diplomatic move you made.
Yeah, I mean, conventionally that might be true, but Kim Jong-un, with his sort of young mind and his obvious, you know, liking for the U.S.-style basketball, you know, having invited Dennis Rodman a couple of times, who knows, maybe that kind of personal approach might work with Kim Jong-un. I mean, Kim Jong-un is very much still a relatively unknown X factor. We don't really know what his personality is like. We know that he's been very effective in consolidating his power. So with a personal message like this, maybe it might appeal to Kim Jong-un, maybe not, but I think it's worth a shot.
Right. And we have seen that President Moon Jae-in is certainly one thing that sets him clearly apart from his liberal predecessors is the way he approached the global stage as a diplomat. Certainly we can give him high grade, high marks and strong props for that, especially with what he's displayed today.
Yeah, that, and you know, when he met with Prime Minister Merkel, it seems that they could get along fine. I mean, he seemed to have gotten along pretty well with President Trump himself. So,
which is amazing. How do you be an adapter that can have a pleasant conversation with Merkel at the same time have a solid handshake and a friendly time with President Trump? It seems like something that's very underrated on the part of President Moon Jae-in at this point.
That too, and I guess the power of preparation, you know, all the events that have taken place with, you know, President Trump going through, you know, the Canadian Prime Minister, the French President, and Angela Merkel herself, I think those probably helped President Moon a great deal.
And I understand on his way to the venue, the historic venue today, after holding a summit talks with President Xi Jinping and German Chancellor Angela Merkel, I heard President Moon may have made some minor adjustments that may have have worked wonders. Which part do you think may be those that President Moon Jae-in decided to highlight a little bit more of or try to tone down a little?
I mean, I guess this is my guess, but if his aides, when he was they were preparing his speech, probably felt like more like a policy speech. But the way that he delivered it, had a lot more personal touch addressed to Kim Jong-un himself.
Right. Certainly, we are very excited to what we can expect from the G20 summit. As we mentioned before, this could be a bigger chance to use it as a bigger and more effective loudspeaker to reach out to the rest of the world. And when the G20 summit begins, it's a big event, but that means a lot of big names and big egos and very little time to cover on the details. So this was a very meaningful way to address the world, not just to talk about North Korean threats, but where South Korea stands on ways to approach the vision for peaceful inter-Korean relations. Well, thank you so much for your time and your insights today, Professor Hwang Jung-woo.
Thank you very much.